Thanks for watching Harmonizer TV. We got a lot of feedback on our first Harmonizer TV episode. They said, why is the musical intro not Barbershop? Well, we're gonna fix that, and we're gonna need your help. More on that in another episode. Society President Shannon Elswick asked Society CEO Marty Monson to deliver the keynote address for the board at the Society's 2013 Midwinter Convention on January 10th. That's Marty Monson, not Monson. We got it wrong in episode one. Marty used this opportunity to encourage Society chapters and Society leaders to think outside of the box, especially outside of the chapter meeting box. Marty has been doing a lot of reading. Don't ask me where he gets the time to read. The guy never stops moving. It's amazing to see how much he knows about early Society history, and especially about the thoughts of early Society leaders and what this Society is and what we should be doing. You're going to find a lot of wisdom from the Society's founder in his address. He also quotes Val Hicks, who wrote about the future of the Society 25 years ago on our 50th anniversary. And you may have heard it's now our 75th anniversary. We'd love to hear what your quartet or chorus is doing to celebrate. You're going to get some real insight into Marty's way of thinking. His address is entitled, Are You Looking Outside the Window? You're also going to get an idea of how he is modeling the behavior that he's going to ask all of us to live up to. In the next issue of The Harmonizer, which you already know is late, but I think you're going to like what's in it, you're going to get an idea of what looking outside the window looks from a society-wide perspective. In Marty's keynote, he also references some recent articles from The Harmonizer, which again is late, but it's going to be more than 100 pages in two issues that we're going to mail together, and Rome wasn't built in a day. Articles about chapters that looked outside their window and started to realize that they had a lot to offer their communities. So without further interruption, let's watch Marty's keynote address, Are You Looking Through the Window? I said Monson, not Monson. It's worth the time. Thanks for watching Harmonizer TV. Not Monson, Monson.
Many of you recall the first meeting that took place in 1938 at the Tulsa Hotel. But what's important is what took place after that. We went from 26 to 50 on that second meeting at the Tulsa Hotel a week later. Pretty amazing. The third meeting took place at the Alvin Hotel, and it jumped up to 150 people. Pretty amazing. I wonder what kind of social media they were using at the time as it relates to that. I'd love to buy into that. But on that second floor of that hotel, they were having fun singing, and one of the gentlemen pulled one of the founders over to the window. They didn't have air conditioning, most likely, at that point in time, and they looked outside, and they saw the commotion that was going on. And the founder said, well, that's kind of interesting, but we got business to attend to. Let's get back and start singing. What happened at that point in time was the Tulsa World, a reporter from the Tulsa World came up and was asking questions and asked one of the founders and said, hey, is this taking place anywhere else? And the founder quickly reacted and said, I think, yeah, it is. It's actually a buddy of mine that I've sung with is in St. Louis, and he's starting a meeting and having a meeting very soon. The next morning, that caught the St. Louis press. And the founder received a phone call from this gentleman from St. Louis saying, what are you doing? I've received 75 phone calls by 10 a.m. this morning. The story moves along, and my point of the story is twofold. The first part, they had no inkling or idea of a society. In fact, the whole aspect of getting together those meetings was to generate a directory of people that wanted to get together and sing in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Look what's happened since. The second point, which is probably more important, is that when he went to the window and looked out the window, what had been all this traffic jam and people looking up and all those types of things, what that was happening was because of what was going on the second floor. But yet we had to get back to singing. We were causing the commotion. We were the cause of all that activity in Tulsa, Oklahoma that day, which then spread like wildfire. So what have we done? 75 years later, we've had gold medal achievements. We're the largest all-male singing organization in the world, second to none. Quite an achievement. I don't think they envisioned that at that point in time either. We have an old songs library, the largest private collection of songs dating back to the early 1800s, 115,000 and still counting. This year, we will have overcome and exceeded over $500,000 in music sales with over 6,000 arrangements, with very little effort, mostly internal. We have the most admired contest administration and adjudication system in the world. I've gone out externally, and they admire us and can't believe the structure that we have. A lot of our guys go out and contribute to other areas of that around the country. We have over 10,000 young men and women participating in our annual Youth in Harmony programs. Over 60 events this past year. 60 events, that's more than one a week. Our Harmony University colleges, directors, quartet, next generation, music educator, that focused effort, we're admired with that as well, from the outside looking in. They can't believe that we can get together for a week and have all this structure. We should be accredited in my mind. We've achieved silver screen. We're on Comcast On Demand. We've had PBS specials. We have the Harmonizer. And we also have the recently launched Harmonizer TV. We hold over 60 international and regional conventions a year. You add that with the Youth in Harmony events, now we're almost 3 or 2.5 events a week. That's economic stimulus that we've survived, and we haven't even asked for anything. What an organization. Now that's a lot of barbershop. So where do we go next? I firmly believe that the answers are not necessarily what we think about internally, but they're outside. I go back to the 50th anniversary, the Heritage Harmony by Val Hicks at a culmination in 1988 that he pulled together. And it was interesting, the first few chapters he talks about the historical aspects. But then he gives us the next 50 years and the next decade. But he states this: the first 5 decades have taught several vital lessons. First of all, it becomes evident that society members have not yet fully caught the vision of service and public awareness contained in Article 2 of the society bylaws. Perhaps barbershoppers have indulged their bent towards self-entertainment at the expense of greater outside world of public awareness and service. Well, you're probably wondering what those articles state. And Jim Warner, Chris Bruegel, you want to just state them out by memory? You probably have that capacity. but I happen to have them right here. The first one, to perpetuate the old American institution, the barbershop quartet, and to promote and encourage vocal harmony and good fellowship among its members throughout the world by the formation of local chapters and districts composed of members interested in the purposes of this corporation. Check. To hold annual local district, state, national, and international contests in quartet and chorus singing. Check. There are six of them. We have four left. To encourage and promote the education of its members and the public in music appreciation. And to promote public appreciation of barbershop quartet and chorus singing by publication and dissemination thereof. To initiate, promote, and participate in charitable projects. And to establish and maintain music scholarships and charitable foundations. To initiate and maintain a broad program of musical education, particularly in the field of vocal harmony and the allied arts. I'm not here to debate these purposes and the focus. I'm just here to bring them to your attention. And with that, I've got some examples. Nova Scotia's Cape Breton Chordsman. It's pretty interesting what happened with this particular chapter. In 2008, they had 12 gentlemen, and they were thinking about folding at that point in time. But the first thing that they realized, in two years later, and they've maintained since 2010, 40 members in that chapter. What happened? The first thing was attitude and belief. You got to believe first. You have to have it's a mindset. You got to have optimism that you can do something. You have to. That's part of the whole belonging. It's part of that chapter. You got to have life. But then they realized once they had that change with those same 12 guys, they didn't get any new guys at that point in time when they realized it. They just started going out. They started getting out into the community. They felt that if they got into the community, their odds were better than if they weren't. If they just stayed in the four walls and did all that, how were they going to grow? They also realized that men wanted to belong to a group that has a winning vision, not just a contest-winning vision, but a vision to have an impact. I feel good. I'm winning. I'm winning as to the little society by contributing to my community. At the same time, though, we can't forget this. They had a hunger for singing well and new ideas and fresh components to their regular meetings and their attitudes and their community. Really critical to that experience. Oregon's Rogue Valley Harmonizers. They're another interesting approach, but they approached it going out into the community. In fact, what's really I love about their philosophy is this next statement. When your mouth is open, you're selling. When your ears are open, you're marketing. I love that concept. We have so many great things. We just listed about 7 or 8 of them. To talk about the achievements we have achieved in 75 years. Those are some pretty cool, awesome things. How do we leverage that? By just listening to our communities to let them tell us what they need. So then we can align to them and become relevant in the community. But you got to be in the giving aspect. It's got to be no strings attached. It's the concept of serving versus being served, right? All of these components, But this is critical. The more marketing, and the marketing is not go out and tell everybody. The marketing is listening to what your community has to say. So what did they find? They found a couple weaknesses in their community. One was the lack of music in schools. That's a common theme, isn't it? The other one was a lack of entertainment in the care communities. They struggled because there was a perception issue of the barbershop in their town. And they needed to change. They were trying to give free tickets away to their concerts, and nobody came. So what did they do? They aligned to their strengths. And their strengths were access to great music. We just showed it. That access, then they funded a program where they got some funders to buy some music and put it into the schools. They had people that could go into the schools and help deliver on that program during the day. They also had a great, entertaining annual show. So they recorded it, put it on DVD, and they found out that in their community there was a local cable station that wanted to post this out there. They needed content. So what they did is they took that DVD and showed it on Christmas Day and New Year's Day. The rest is history. They're thriving. And more importantly, their community knows who they are, and they've changed the perception. Their guidance to all of us in that article: we tend to think as barbershops internally focused. How do we get outside? How do we look through the window to align ourselves? No strings attached. So you're wondering, what's the society going to do? I've been here now almost 5 months. I'm excited about all the stimulus that's going on. This is my view. My view is external. As the guys know in the office, I don't sit much, but when I do, I know the answers are out there. They're not necessarily in here, because I already know what we provide. I just went through it. It's how do I align that? How do we align that out to our little society, right, with a small s, to become relevant? But we got to listen. We got to know where those are at. I could go into lots of areas, but I'm going to share with you one particular area that we are extremely, extremely excited about. And this is a relationship when I came in, and of course with my upbringing, being focused in learning what music educators do and their challenges in today's world about choral music in general. Guys and ladies, we don't have barbershop if vocal music doesn't continue or have an opportunity to succeed or even get started in certain schools. We don't have singers. And this is a national, global crisis. So what did we do? One of the first days that I was there, we had a day and a half strategy session with the music education team. And we collaborated and worked through. And we found a commonality with the ACDA, American Choral Directors Association. Is Scott here? Scott, where are you? Director of Education, right back here. He's the Director of Education from the ACDA in this back row. But we were collaborating, and we were trying to discern what we should do. And there's a perception out there, isn't there, between the music educators and the Barbershop Harmony Society. And there's this wall right in between. Not in all cases, not in all communities, but there's this perception thing. And we got to break down that barrier, because we can help. No strings attached. We can help them. We can help the choral music educator. We have great programs. We've got great solutions. It starts as a quartet. So we came up with the solution. And the solution is a 3-year plan, primarily focused around the ACDA convention schedule. Their structure is that they have a national conference every 2 years. Their national conference is in March, and it's taking place in Dallas, Texas. In 2014, they have 7 regional, like our districts, and we're committed to being there as well. And then the following year, this is the high-level plan, is to be back at national, but then be in as many states as possible. We're doing this in Canada as well, but I'm just kind of giving you the components here. This kind of focus to make sure people understand that we're here to help. No strings attached. We cannot lead, though. This is not a recruiting tool. This is not a way to gain membership. If you lead with that, the barrier will still stay there. They have to have the peace of mind and trust that we're here to truly help them. We're excited about it. One of the main reasons why is we're doing reading sessions again. We're crafting, we're strategizing on what is some of that great music that we're selling. We have our number one charts. We know that's successful. Many of you came through that mechanism because you were exposed to that. I certainly was. But we're missing that. We're missing some of those opportunities. We're seeing them in pockets, and I know it's happening, but that's what's taking place. One of the interesting components of talking with Dr. Tim Sharp, who is my counterpart for ACDA, he came in December for a half of a day. And we started strategizing and talking about all the different components in the similar type of areas that we have. And there's two kind of components that we have really in common. ACDA focuses on the directors, right? The people who go to school and gain that skill set. What we are an envy to that organization in that we're not just the directors, but we're the participants. Other music educators that I've talked to, they say, man, I can't believe how you're able to retain participants to pay dues on a platform. It's amazing. How do you do it? How do you do it? And not just by a couple thousand, but 24,000. Pretty amazing. But we talked about that, and he said, there's two common things. He said, we've got a tsunami happening. This baby boomer generation is moving in, and community choirs are needing help. But at the same time, a lot of directors are graduating too and retiring. How can they help? How can they stay involved? Well, to ACDA, we are 800-plus community choirs. We have an opportunity to help them meet their mission. The second piece is the whole Young Men in Harmony component. Our Young Men in Harmony started in 1966. Abe Gould. Anybody know Abe? In California, it kind of started there. And the whole concept of the program at the time was that it was a gathering of a number of high schools, and the proceeds of the concert then would go towards scholarships. Well, they had decent success in 67, but they really had success in 68. That went on in 1972. We embraced the whole MENC component, and this was a big development. MENC at the time, the Music Education National Conference or Convention, they approved the barbershop category into the segments of state contests. So we became legitimized. And we've maintained that sense. We've done not a very good job keeping up with the repertoire, but we're working on that, and the staff is working on getting that up with a lot of the volunteers out there. But the youth and the starting of youth, Dr. Sharp gave me an example. He said in the youth choirs, there was a school district in Mississippi or Alabama. I'm not quite remember where it is. But they lost their entire elementary and choral music program in their schools. Those instructors, music educators, left and they started a community choir. And after 4 years of building up this community choir, having concerts and developing cash flow and all these types of things, they were able to fund 2 full-time positions back into that school so that music could continue back in the schools for all kids. That's powerful. Why can't we be a part of that? Why can't we give to that? It will pay dividends, more than dividends, coming back through. That's such a beautiful story. And I believe we have the infrastructure, the people, the motivation to do and replicate a very similar example. Here's some of the ads we've been putting in the Choral Journal. And the newest one is this last one right here that's coming in March. Warning, testosterone. After this reading session, you may need to shave. How's that? We in the office love what we do. And you do too. This is one area, and I could talk for a long period of time on this opportunity. But what am I leaving you with here on this point? I go back to Val Hicks in the first point. And he talked about self-entertainment versus servicing. Right? I gave you some examples of what we talked about. The window example, even with our third meeting. But there's a part two to his point. The broad scope of these purposes and powers is a challenge to chapters and districts to get beyond self-entertainment and musical self-indulgence. By more giving and less taking, barbershoppers can help solve problems that the future may hold for the society. I'm not here to take away the fun. In fact, I love tag singing, I love quartetting, I love competition, I love all of that. That's what makes me who I am today. But today's world versus when we began has changed. And this is our opportunity. I covered a ton of stuff. From the days of looking at the window and realizing I got distracted, I want to get back, but all the commotion and the traffic jam. To the stories, to Val Hicks' components in the future. But what I need is help. I need you in your areas to do more marketing, to do more listening, to align yourself where all the good things that we have can be applied into our own backyard and our own communities. I need your help to be that attitude changer that we can do it. We can. I'm here to tell you we can. Are you looking through the window? I certainly am. Thank you.